Here we have a short video in which I remind myself, my future self, on how to perform multi-channel ADC DMA conversions, but that are synchronized to a timer rather than being kicked off manually by a timer. So I'm going to start off by showing me the way I don't want to do it, and then how to make it work the way I do want to make it work. So obviously we need a timer, and we need an analog to digital converter setup. I've already set up the project. The keen eye can spot that I can't spell STM32, but there you go, it doesn't really matter. So here's an ADC. It's a very simple device I'm using, STM32F030k6T6. It's one of the very cheapest parts and the least well specified, but it's enough for this purpose. It's quite nice sometimes just to use the simplest parts because they don't have the extra complexity that sometimes confuses these things. So I've just randomly selected four channels. One is internal and three are external. You can see the pins here, 1, 2, 3, and obviously you can't see a pin for the temperature sensor. And I've got a debug output which you can see on the oscilloscope in the little inset window. And there's not much going on here. It's pretty much a standard configuration, but do note that continuous, discontinuous and DMA continuous are all disabled. And the triggering mechanism, the thing that starts off an A to D conversion, is regular conversion launched by software. So a fairly vanilla setup of the A to D converter. Let's have a look at the timer. I'm using timer 1 for reasons that will become apparent in a bit, but not now. And all I've done here is I've set up an internal clock source, and in the parameter settings, oh, by the way, I've set the clock to 16 megahertz from the default of 8, don't really know why. And I want a millisecond pulse from this, that's the period at which I want to, the frequency with which I want to do the A to D conversions. Which means that I need something happening every 16,000 pulses. And because of the nature of the timer, you lop off one for good measure, and that will actually give you the 16,000 that you care about. In the NVIC settings, that's the interrupt settings, you can see that I've got just this one set. And going back to the ADC, in the NVIC settings, you can see that I've just got the DMA set, which you can't do until you set up the DMA, which I forgot to tell you about. So I clicked add, I added the only option that you can, which is this one, and I created a circular, by default this isn't circular, but I wanted to wrap round and overwrite the results. And all the other parameters are fine, it's half word and half word. Half word on a 32-bit system is 16 bits, which is more than enough for a 12-bit A to D converter, so that's fine. Good, let's have a look at the actual code. Now in main, apart from reserving some space for the A to D conversion results, which are stored as UIN16T, and it's an array of size 4, and that's because there were 4 ADC channels set up. So apart from that, the only thing I'm doing in main, all this gubbins here is what's created by the code generation from the IOC file. The only thing I'm doing in main is starting timer 1. You can see just below it the while 1 loop is completely empty, there's nothing going on there. Now in the callback function for timer 1, which is weakly defined, which means you can overwrite it, in the drivers directory somewhere, you can dig around in the files and find the relevant one. For the timer, it'll be somewhere in driver inc. Actually, that's not the right one to look in, it's better to look in source. And you can see that there's HAL ADC, HAL flash, HAL this, HAL that. And in HAL TIM, you'll find the original definition of this. So if you can't remember what this should look like, just dig around in there, find it, remove the weak word at the front as I've done here. Now in the period elapsed callback, you should be checking to see if the timer is timer 1 in this instance, but in this demo I'm only using the one timer, so there's no need for that sort of stuff. And all I'm doing is setting a debug pin so that you can see it on the scope, that's the rising edge you see on the scope, and then I'm triggering the A to D conversion. Okay, and then in a month, another millisecond's time, the same thing will happen. But before that, hopefully, the A to D will complete, and then the callback for the conversion complete will be triggered. And that happens when the DMA has finished filling up the channels. And again, in this instance, all I'm actually doing is toggling the pin low. So you can see under the oscilloscope that every 1 millisecond, you get an up pulse, which is the timer, and a down pulse, which is the completion of the ADC. That's fine. Now that's fine and it works, and there's nothing wrong with that. And of course you can set the period of timer one to be whatever you like, no problem. But I don't like it because I sort of want it to be a bit more automatic than that. So although this works, what I wanted to do was to create a version in which the conversion of the A to D conversion is automatically triggered by the period elapsed pulse within it. So you don't need the software call here, you can just do it directly. So there'll be a short break while I stop this, use the fact that I rather cleverly used Git to set things up and toggle between the two versions of software. Alrighty. And when it's finished spinning its wheel, I'll go back into the IOC file and show you what's changed. Clunk, clunk, whir, whir. Goody, goody. So what's important in the timer, he says, trying to remember what's important in the timer, is that we now need to have an update event. I think it was actually set in the previous code, but it didn't make any difference. It wasn't actually doing anything. But this is what will be used with the new ADC configuration to trigger things. The pulse rate is still every 16,000 pulses, i.e. 1 millisecond. And everything else is the same. I don't think I've done anything extra here. No, I haven't. Obviously, we don't need DMA. So all I've really done here, the internal clock source is the same. All these bits and bobs are the same. I've just made sure that the trigger event selection is set to update event. Everything else is as it was before. Now in the analog window, things are a little bit different. The DMA is the same. The NVIC settings is the same, but the parameter settings is a tiny bit different. Now we've got DMA continuous requests ticked, and the external trigger conversion source is no longer regular conversion by software, but timer one trigger out event. Now there are some other options. Indeed, you can use timer three trigger output event, but you can see now why, of all the timers that I could have used to simply create a millisecond pulse, in the event of trying to do something with the A to D converter on this particular chip, it had to be timer 1 or timer 3. If I'd used timer 16, it's not an option to trigger things here. So again, DMA is the same, exactly the same as before. The NVIC settings are the same as before. This is a wee bit different, and you're free to fiddle with all these parameters if you want to. Oh, by the way, for people who don't know, because I didn't, the asynchronous clock mode here means using this asynchronous 14 megahertz clock to do its business, and the other options mean it uses a scaled down version of the system clock instead. So there you go. But for the purposes of what we're doing here, it doesn't make any difference. So let's have a look at the code itself. Back in the code. Now, what's different? Well, because we're not triggering an A to D conversion every millisecond, it's being done automatically. That means that we do need a kickoff event. So in main, in addition to starting the timer, I'm now also starting the ADC DMA. And that's the same as it was before, except for it's now done just before the while loop. In the handlers, I've now removed the call to manually kick off the A to D conversion from the timer one callback function because it's now an automatic process. So in fact, I don't need this at all. I've just got it here to continue toggling the pins. and obviously the point in time at which the conversions are complete is still this callback function. So here you could, for example, set a global ADC complete or something like that, and then in your while one loop just act accordingly if you wish. Right, let's see if that compiles and does stuff. Have a quick look at the scope and notice it all disappears whilst the device switches off, and then bang, it's back up and running and everything's absolutely fine. And just to prove to you that I really don't need the timer callback, I still need to have the interrupt set in the IOC file, but by getting rid of this it will fall back to the weak version of this period elapsed callback function, which is defined in the driver's subdirectory, and it doesn't do anything basically, it's just empty. So again, look at the scope, you'll see that it disappears whilst it's compiling and downloading, and then now you see, here's the thing, it's not apparently doing anything because I'm no longer setting the bit. But if I try and outsmart yourself, what I can do, if I can learn to use a keyboard, that's it, I can just do something like that. Will that be enough? Will we see it on the scope? Oh, she blows. Look at that. So that little pulse there is just confirming the end of conversion. So there you go. That's how to do regularly timed rather than just asynchronous, whatever rate it feels like, conversions, multi-channel, DMA. All good. Thank you for watching.